TG, I had a weird idea. In D&D, mindless undead are capable of following simple tasks such as attack anyone who enters this room, or stay here until this alarm sounds, then attack the nearest village. Most of the commands they're capable of can be broken down into simple logical statements like if X, then Y, such as the attacking one being if something enters this room, attack them. Do you think that with enough undead, with the right commands, you could effectively create a computer? Undead logic gates are like the way you think. It'd be huge and slow, but that's what pocket planes with faster time flow are for. Using whole zombies or skeletons would consume too much space, but maybe you could use skulls or hands as components. I wonder how many skeletons would an undead calculator involve? For a simple calculator, you'd need a huge dungeon and lots of time. RTG, this is why I love you. No op, what you need to do is create a dynamo and make a horde of skeletons pedal 1,000 bikes for eternity, thereby producing free electricity for eternity. Captain of the industry. What if you just animated really tiny undead, like pixies or something, and then applied reduction to them? You could make the space required shrink considerably. Maybe the size of a large room. Every second, look at those two zombies. If only one of them has its hand up, put your hand up. And then you have an AND gate, and technically can build any logical circuit from there. Memory storage is going to be a bitch, though. Guys. Hey guys, hear me out on this one. What if? Honestly guys, listen, what if one of Tucker's kobolds was a necromancer with lots of time and they had access to this undead computer? We need to work on this. Guys, I want to wipe a party and explain to them that they just got killed by computer science. Lich makes a computer out of undead. I am running this one shot. I am running it so hard. A demiplane full of skeletons, with a vastly accelerated time rate and a limited gate to access it. Add a bound lich to the mix, as a command center. Build multiple tiny access points in the form of calculators. Start a business. Later models include permanently reduced and hasted pixie skeletons. Welcome to the lair of the dread lich Corthus. Why are half of the zombies here marked 1 and the other half marked 0? He's got a theory he's trying out. Something to do with creating the world's largest self-generating computer. Wait. Lich is programmer. Fine. Skeletons are software. Cool. Dungeons are circuit boards. Whatever. Adventurers. Are those viruses? Yep. I so often forget to tell you how much I love you, TG. With this, we shall rewrite troll GM history. You could even, after successfully building the undead computer, write a code that instructs it to send out warrior undead to gather more bodies to add to the computer. It could eventually be so advanced it becomes self-aware, a mind made of the mindless. Bards equals spam virus, rogues equals trojans, druids equals botnoting cleric, sorcerer, wizard, monk, fighter, ranger equals question mark my next big bad evil guy's undead Skynet skeleton computer. Oh dear god, this is brilliant. This is an insane, impractical idea that abuses the rules of the system to produce a result that is so ridiculously fantastic and useful it could be used to pretty much break the game world. In other words, yet another wonderful creation from TG that fills me with nerd joy. Good. OP. Good. What if the original program expanded itself while recreating itself? Sure, the interior program would never become a true copy of the whole program this way, but it would constantly mimic it in a way that eventually would surpass what the main program originally was. This would be possible with a growing undead computer network, right? Okay, I'm partly talking out of my ass here, but I guess you all know that I am no quantum scientist or STH, just an interested hobbyist. That said, it would be possible for the program inside the program to create a matrix DF some shit Lickothot environment, but never up to the point to recreating the size of the original. The memory power used by the subprocess will never be able to exceed the original program it is run in, but in theory there is the possibility to somehow bend time. Now is the point where it gets really theoretical and you need real world literature to find those theories explained in detail. But, the memory used in the subprogram can never exceed that of the original program. But with enough storage, you could probably bend time inside the subprogram, calculating everything at a slower pace, using the available memory of the original program to its maximum extent to create a slower moving copy of the original program. By bending time even more, you could make a program inside a program bigger than the original program. Disclaimer. All I just said is to the best of my knowledge, but I don't tell you that I fully get it. It's really theoretical and really scientific. Go to your local library or bookstore to learn more. Or, you know, just have them pull levers to open floodgates or something. It's funny. It's funny because I'm having an exam on logical gates in 3 hours. This thread is actually helping me pass the class. More NAND and NOR gates. Wait, I have a question. What is loot? I mean, adventurers go in as viruses and then kill stuff. Why does skeleton number 23 have a potion of bark skin on him? What part of skeleton computers does this play? Op, you are a scholar. Here is my idea. The lich is trying to figure out some MacGuffin spell computation. It takes forever to figure out, and because of the nature of the MacGuffin, you will forget the first half by the time you finish the second half, thus invalidating the entire process. That is where the skeleton computer comes in. He gets each set of skeletons to observe a certain parameter, and if it works a certain way, they raise their hand. Then if both skeletons on either side of the next tier skeleton raises their hands, that skeleton raises its hand, and so on for a super long time. Above it all is a flying skull that has a ream of parchment in its mouth, and as the skull flies over the mass of raised hands, it actually uses its individual teeth to punch out a punch card that keeps record of every single raised hand. Then the lich will be able to bring all the punch cards of doom together and use it to sing the song that ends the world. I just had an idea. What if, say, lots and lots of undead have suddenly appeared in an area, and at night they go out to hunt for living beings to drag back to wherever they come from? Naturally, a group of adventurers will hear of this and come have a look. They find the usual underground dungeons, full of skeletons, zombies and stuff, although they are marked with different colors, and some of them are completely prone. And after a while they stumble on a set of rooms where the floor is uneven. In fact, it's a labyrinth, full of shrunken skeletons in different colors, running around, seemingly at random. But if anyone in the party is clever, he might notice that they seem to have some form of pattern they move in, and a group of standard sized undead move around and use wands of, say, permanent light, to light up colored windows into the dungeon. There is no end boss. Clerics are either the kind of virus that deletes your files, good cleric turning, or the kind that takes control over your mouse and keyboard, evil cleric rebuking. Wizards are all kinds of viruses, from the kind that keylog, screeing wizards, to the kind that multiply and fill up your HD, necromancer making his own undead, to the kind that makes lots of pop-ups, illusionist, and also potentially the kind that DLS and installs other viruses onto your computer, high level time and reality changing spells and summon monsters. Paladin is the kind that either corrupts or out and out deletes your files, smite evil or turn undead. Fighters corrupt your files. They destroy undead, but the undead's body is still there to be reanimated. Bards are those annoying pop-ups that don't really cause any harm but take a couple seconds to click the X. Wouldn't you also need a number of skeletons undead to create a dot matrix type screen to display the output as well? Just so you know, it's actually readable by people. For data storage, just paint dots on a plank of hardwood. Have a set of skeletons who move these planks around and tend to the shelves. Have an additional memory space to keep track of stored planks. Have a set of skeletons who can read the planks. There, our computer has a punch card memory. We could even make it programmable this way. Well, I think I will run this. I'll probably have the lich be waging a war for more corpses simultaneously on every kind of populated plane there is. I'm not sure what the goal of the calculation will ultimately be. Maybe just an off switch for reality without all of that fussing about with negative energy or elder evils. I'll also definitely feature the AI. That's a wonderful idea. Plus, if the calculation is in some way connected to reality that allows for the spell that throws the player's minds into this calculated reality and thus a matrix side adventure. Thanks TG, you've just given me what looks like a potentially very epic campaign. I like the idea of a skull that uses its teeth to make punch cards better. The punch cards represent which skeletons are supposed to have their hands up. Also, I find there are so many ways to use this concept. For starters, have your players attempting to stop a lich from using an epic level spell he found, It gives everything around it 2d8 negative levels. Anything that is level 0 or minus 1 dies. Anything that goes to minus 4 becomes a skeleton. Minus 8 is skeleton lord. Minus 12 is skeleton master. The lich is attempting to use this epic spell to get skeletons to make his computer. Your party has to stop it, but in the end they fail, causing the skeleton computer to form. Now they must figure out what its purpose is and how to stop it. I still advocate a shrunken maze full of shrunken gnome skeletons. Why? Because that way you can set off a chain reaction without relying too much on skeleton intelligence. They just have to go here when this happens. Keep a group at every turn so there'll always be enough. And it also gives you an excuse to turn hundreds or even thousands of gnomes into undead and then shrink them. Why gnomes? Because they're already short, which makes them shorter when you shrink them. And they have reasonably thick bones, unlike halflings. And when the system registers that fewer skeletons are moving around, they signal for others to find more future skeletons which they can turn using wands and such. Hey, you fucking munchkins with your wings of flurry and your wishes and you wall of rape or whatever. You are small time. This is how you game break 3.5. Let it be known, T gentlemen, wouldn't the undead AI itself become able to cast spells as its intelligence increased? In fact, it would be able to cast spells like a wizard relatively easily. Wizards cast spells based on hand motions, timing and saying certain words that they have memorized. Correct shit. Formula like that is what computers were made for. As the memory and size of the undead computer increased, so would the casting power. Bifurcate the processes and create sub-programs running simultaneously in the dungeon itself would be able to cast multiple spells at a time out of seemingly nowhere, using next to no stored memory. And since a computer wouldn't need to worry about forgetting the spells after casting, just having a 20 go to 10 kind of setup after the cast is over to recast it, it would have theoretically unlimited spell slots. At least, that is how I've always understood wizards to work at least. Can anyone who has looked into it more confirm or deny this? Cleric casting 10 undead is equivalent to some jerk dropping a giant electromagnet on your hard drives. One, considering the reaction time of undeads, it will take thousands of years to do the most basic stuff. Two, even one zombie not paying 100% attention will fuck the whole thing up. Three, you can do it better with magically enchanted stones or something. Four, in a world with magic you don't really need computers. Five, zombie computer is cool. Ignore the above. Could have the lich use the compute to calculate the tax for the surrounding kingdoms and get paid in corpses to do it. Would also press the whole operation into a more legit territory. I have been on 4chan for a long goddamn time, and there are very, very few threads I'd count as legendary. This is one such thread. Holy shit. I still can't think of anything that the computer would be calculating if it's run by a lich. I do very much like the idea of it being an RE wizard, but then it's very easy to disrupt, I would think. Would make for an epic final encounter if done right though. Before the adventurers get into the dungeon, have it guarded by a wall of fire and a troll named Norton. Skullfuck is simple programming language designed for 8 bone computers. A Skullfuck interpreter consists of a shambling blasphemous mound of composite flesh and bone from as few as 1 to as many as 8 formerly humanoid creatures. The interpreter must be able to understand a total of 8 commands, though it is not necessary that anyone know them all. Exact composition depends on the capabilities of the undead minions you have available. Input and output depend on the available materials. This author suggests an array of a few thousand reusable octagonal knobs, though it is possible to design a skullfuck program to work around the problems inherent in other media such as wood, stone, or live flesh. A skullfuck program consists of a scroll with regularly spaced command runes. In this example I describe an interpreter consisting of several skeletons horrifyingly joined at the waist, such that they moved together along a long hall with regularly spaced octagonal knobs. One skeleton, the instruction pointer, is instructed to recognize the current rune on the instruction scroll and activate the matching skeleton branded with that rune. Activation is performed by smacking it in the skull. One skeleton responds to the rune and leads the shambling mound to the next knob down the hall. A second skeleton responds to the rune and leads it in the opposite direction the same distance. One skeleton responds to the rune by turning the knob before it 1/8 of a turn to the right. Another responds to by turning the knob 1/8 of a turn left. Note, with cleverer undead this could be reduced to a more efficient single skeleton. Cf. Mir's Law. One skeleton holds the top of instruction scroll in view of the instruction pointer and itself and the next skeleton. It responds to the rune. If the present knob is in any but the original zero position, it turns the instruction scroll backwards until it sees a, and then forward once to the subsequent rune. The last skeleton in this version holds the bottom of the scroll and responds to the rune by observing if the current knob is in the zero position. If it is, it turns the instruction scroll to the first rune following the first that it sees. It also turns the scroll one position after any other skeleton is activated by the instruction pointer. To do, I.O. Scratch the octagonal knobs. Replace with knobs however many characters your desired language has, provided your skeletons have the manual dexterity required to orient them with the required accuracy. Output in one embodiment utilizes a skeleton equipped with a wax or chalk tablet with the dexterity required to form the desired characters. It is activated by the instruction pointer on the rune and observes the symbol indicated by the orientation of the knob before it and records it on the tablet. Another embodiment of output involves the output skeleton pulling a chain winch covered in symbols until the desired symbol appears and then releasing it in a fashion similar to a rotary skull phone. This may be used to drive a white and blood color display or a bonyphone audio device. Input is performed by a skeleton equipped with an input scroll activated on the rune that turns the knob to face the symbol indicated by the present position on the scroll and then turning the scroll to the next position. Interactive input is not yet supported by Skullfuck. The grid. A digital frontier. I tried to picture clusters of information as they move through the computer. What did they look like? Ships, motorcycles, were the circuits like freeways? I kept dreaming of a world I thought I'd never see. And then, one day, I got in. Guys, eventually this thing will gain its own sentience. And then, its own class levels, and then it becomes a god, worshipped by many. See, in D&D the primordial evils always are trying to come back. Well, after the robot computer undead god is created, there's this big race of a deity war. Gods killing gods to get their powers. Leaving only a few left in all the multiverse of Spelljammer. Eventually, with no divine power to fool its existence, all of that reality is compresses into one world creation. And there the primordials break free and overthrow the remaining deities. After eons and eons the deities start giving their powers back to humans, but more so than ever before. These new clerics held powers the old clerics couldn't dream about. Pella's first words to his exalts? I am the unconquerable sun. There was a great whooshing sound and a loud crack like thunder. So fast and so deafening I was afraid I won't be able to hear anything else ever again. As it stopped the cultist said it is finished, rolling his eyes, whites glowing unhealthily in the dark. This iteration is finished. I realized he must have been screaming for us to even hear. He undoubtedly alerted whatever lurked further in this dungeon and I smacked him with the hilt of my sword, cursing his madness. Suddenly the noise started again and we saw dim light at the end of the tunnel. We followed it onto an underground plateau, washed in amber light coming from countless magical orbs suspended above were skeletons. An army, a host, number so great it boggled the mind. Rows upon rows of skeletons, layer after layer, suspended in midair, neatly packed into the available space. Our eyes refused to count them. They were constantly putting their hands up just to lower them in split second. That was the source of what we heard. There. There is a pattern here. The wizard started. We were startled as the skeletons stopped again. It's just a simple subsystem, rambled the cultist. It calculates an irrational mathematical constant in a decimal notation and stores the result. Every iteration adds further digits. When the signal comes from parts in other realms, it transmits the stored number. As he turned his head to look, marvel at the skeletons, I stabbed him. Then, as we heard thunderous footsteps from a dark area of the plateau, by Pella, we run out of there, leaving the cultist. I heard his laughter suddenly cut off. I did not look back. We continued to hurry through all the levels of the dungeon, back to the surface. We never returned to that mad place and never intend to.